There is a world of difference in the reactivity between phosphomonoesters that we talked about in the last webcast and the phosphodiester functional group that is the topic of this webcast. The phosphodiester functional group links together two organic constituents through oxygen and phosphorus atoms. The two remaining oxygens are going to normally carry a negative charge. The reason is because if that oxygen were protonated, it has a very low pKa, meaning it's a very strong acid. It's actually stronger than phosphomonoesters or phosphoric acid itself. We've encountered phosphodiesters when we talked about nucleic acids. There you can see the structure of DNA. The two organic constituents are the two different ribose rings that are linked together through that phosphodiester linkage. We talked about DNA and RNA as being polyanionic, and the reason is because that proton is never usually bound to that oxygen. Being so acidic, it's almost always lost and forms the polyanionic backbone of nucleic acids. Another example of where phosphodiester linkage shows up in biological chemistry is in lipid bilayers, for example phosphatidylcholine, which has the two different organic constituents shown here. One is attached to a very long chain fatty acids that are hydrophobic, and the other side is very polar. It contains this trialkyl ammonium group, so that overall that negative charge on the phosphodiester is offset by the positive charge on the trialkyl group, meaning that it's a spiderionic entity. This part of the molecule, unlike the other portion of the molecule over here, is very, very hydrophilic to compare to this very hydrophobic entity, and that's how the amphiphilic membrane forms its bilayer structure. The hydrophobic groups back up, back to back, from two different phosphatidylcholine molecules forming the lipid bilayer structure. Well, I briefly mentioned that there's a world of difference in reactivity between the mono and di phosphoesters, and it's summarized for you here. The monoesters are really quite easily hydrolyzed, whereas the phosphodiesters are quite resistant to hydrolysis. And this turns out to be a very important thing for life itself, because the phosphodiester linkage is necessary in order to carry information from one generation of a cell to the next. Since the sequence of DNA is what carries that information, if this linkage underwent hydrolysis, the fidelity of that information would be lost. It's been estimated that the hydrolysis of the phosphodiesters is not only stable on the cell lifetime, but it's actually stable on much longer scales. For example, prehistoric time scales is estimated to be the half-life of the hydrolysis of the phosphodiester group. Under physiological conditions and 37 degrees, about 80 million years is the hydrolysis half-life for the phosphodiester group. Let's look at the non-enzymatic hydrolysis mechanisms, first by looking at the mechanism that we talked about last time, that SN2 process in which the phosphomonoester undergoes hydrolysis, and the key thing to remember is that that proton that was available was able to serve as an intramolecular general acid so that the leaving group could leave in its neutral form. It was a one-step process, and so all we talked about was the transition state structure. In the case of phosphodiesters, there is no proton to serve as a general acid, and so that leaving group leaves as this alkoxide anion. A consequence of that is that a different reaction pathway ensues. This pathway, the SN2-like pathway, is no longer available. Instead, the pathway follows an addition elimination process, much like what we've encountered for typical carbon-oxygen double bond, carbonyl kinds of chemistry. So instead, there is this trigonal bipyramidal intermediate, which is a fully formed intermediate with all bonds are fully formed, unlike the transition state structure where bonds are being formed and being made, and there isn't, in the case of the phosphomonoester, any intermediate at all. So the key difference, just to summarize, emphasize that point, is the nature of the leaving group. And on the next slide, I summarize for you the similarities and the differences. Now the similarities, evidence indicates that the transition states, so in the case of the phosphomonoester, there'll only be a single transition state. In the case of the phosphodiester, there'll be two transition states. But the evidence indicates that all of the transition state involve this oxy-dianion transition state structure, meaning that there's two negative charges in the transition state. And so the negative charges are present in both of the transition states that are found for the phosphodiester hydrolysis mechanism. The outgoing group here is picking up the negative charge, that the second negative charge that existed from that trigonal bipyramidal intermediate. So those are the similarities. As far as the difference goes, the key difference that I really want to emphasize is the one that's shown here, and that is the difference in pKa. Keep the main thing the main thing? Well, the main thing is the pKa difference between the outgoing leaving groups. We have a neutral alcohol in the case of the phosphomonoester, whereas the leaving group for phosphodiesters must be the alkoxide. Above all else, above everything else, this is the main point that you should keep in mind. It is the reason DNA is stable as opposed to phosphomonoesters, which are not stable. These other effects are small. There's delocalization over three oxygen. The negative charge is delocalized over three oxygens in the case of the phosphomonoester. That simply means that this oxygen is actually picking up some of the negative charge as this proton departs, and so we can see that the negative charge is spread over those three oxygen atoms. In the case here, that oxygen is essentially tied up with its organic constituent, so it's not going to pick up any negative charge. And then as far as the pKa difference goes, these are small effects. The big effect is that leaving group effect that's shown here.